Okay. Good evening, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker for today. It's Alexandru Pascadi from University of Oxford. He did his bachelor's at UCLA, and I remember seeing his paper on Rogers Ramanujan identities and mock theta functions, and that's where I actually got to know more about him. He's right now a PhD student at University of Oxford working with James Maynard. He'll be talking today on the dispersion method and beyond, from primes to exceptional mass forms. Over to you, Alexandru.
Great. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's very nice to be here. And as Atul said, I've done some work on Rogers Ramanujan type identities in my undergrad. I've switched fields a bit in between. Now do more classic analytic number theory, but I found some of the ideas to be closely related. So the talk today goes along multiple types of number theory. So I think different parts of it might be interesting to different researchers. I will talk a bit about the dispersion method and in a broad sense and its application in analytic number theory. For concreteness, I will start, and for motivation, I will start by talking about primes in arithmetic progressions to large moduli. Then I'll try to give a broad outline of this dispersion method and what exactly it means. Long story short, it reduces arithmetic problems to sums of exponential sums of a certain nature, in particular Clustermann sums. So then I'll try to talk about exactly how these exponential sums show up. And these particular exponential sums are related to GL2 automorphic forms. And the last section will be about how exactly these automorphic forms show up and how to deal with them. But first, in terms of just primes and arithmetic progressions, I think it dates back to Dirichlet almost 2 centuries ago, that in any arithmetic progression of a form qz plus a, so numbers congruent to a mod q, where a and q are relatively prime, there are infinitely many primes. And in analytic number theory, we'd like to count things a lot, and we like to be as precise as possible with our estimates. So let's try to count the primes up to x. Let's call that pi of x. And I'm also going to count the primes up to x that are congruent to a mod q. And the question is, how many of these are there? Can we compare them? And the prime number theorem, just for the regular primes, says that asymptotically, pi of x is on the order of x over log x. And the Siegel-Valfis theorem says that for small enough moduli q, there are about 1 over phi of q of those primes up to x in each residue class mod q. So the number of primes up to x that are congruent to a mod q up to x is asymptotic to pi of x over phi of q. Phi of q being the number of residue classes mod q that are relatively prime with q. So in other words, these primes are equidistributed in the non-trivial arithmetic progressions mod q. The simplest case is to take q equals 4 when the primes split into two groups, 1 mod 4 and 3 mod 4, other than the one prime that is 2. And even up to a fairly small number like a million, you can already see this phenomenon very clearly, where half of the primes are 1 mod 4 and the other half are 3 mod 4. And this generalizes to any modulus Q. In fact, we can be a bit more precise in this asymptotic, rather than saying that just the limit of a ratio goes to 1 as x goes to infinity. We can say something about the difference. And basically, if you recall that the primes grow like x over log x, for this difference, we can save any power of log x. For any given a, we have that the primes, that this error term between primes congruent to a mod q and just pi of x over phi of q, is at most x over log x to the a for any a. So we can save any power of log. And this is really great and very nice, but it's restricted to small moduli q up to a logarithmic size in x. And this is mainly due to Siegel zeros. If we could rule out Siegel zeros and also the other exceptional zeros of Dirichlet L functions, then we could extend the range of moduli on which this holds almost up to square root of x. And that's a huge difference from a logarithmic size in x to square root of x. And in fact, in analytic number theory, especially in sieve theory, we need such equidistribution estimates that handle large moduli q of size x to the 1/2 or even beyond. And for a fixed modulus q, we can't really say much unconditionally. And we don't just want to assume the generalized Riemann hypothesis everywhere. So what we can do is try to obtain such a result on average over q. Maybe for a fixed q, we can't say more than Siegel-Wallfitz. But if we take some average over q, maybe we can do better. And I'm going to take this average in the following form. So in the middle here, we have the same error term that we've seen before. But I'm going to average this expression. I'm going to sum over q up to some x to the theta of lambda q times this error term, where lambda q are some unbounded weights. And I would still like for this whole expression to save any power of log x over the trivial bound of x. And if this holds, we say that the primes have exponent of distribution theta with respect to the weights lambda q. And this theta shows up in the q at most x to the theta here. So the Siegel-Wallfitz theorem that we've seen before could only handle moduli of logarithmic size in x. So that's essentially theta equals zero. But we want to do better on average. And the main groundbreaking result in this area is due to Bombieri-Vinogradov, who showed back in 1965 that we can handle theta equals 1/2, essentially 1/2 minus epsilon for every epsilon for any unbounded weights lambda q. So you can take absolute values in there. And that's quite remarkable because that's as good as the generalized Riemann hypothesis gives us pointwise in Q. But unconditionally, without assuming GRH and just using Bombieri-Vinogradov, we can get the same strength of theta equals 1/2 on average over Q. And this was, for example, crucial to the proof of Maynard and Polymath that there are infinitely many pairs of primes, PP plus H, with H at most 146, so small gaps between primes, as well as to a bunch of other important results in analytic number theory. And just for the record, conjecturally, we expect to be able to take theta equals 1, 1 minus epsilon. And if we could handle q as large as x, then then that would imply that there exist infinitely many primes with gaps at most 6. So not quite the trim primes conjecture, but pretty close to it. And okay, this barrier at 1/2 is this Bombieri-Vinogradov result is really great, but it sets a limitation at x to the 1/2. And in practice, we often want to go beyond 1/2. And at first sight, that sounds a bit crazy because the generalized Riemann hypothesis only gives q up to x to the 1/2. Is there a question?
No, I guess.
Okay. Okay. My bad. That's a bit crazy at first because even the generalized Riemann hypothesis only gives Q up to X to the half. But that is a pointwise result for a fixed Q, whereas we want a result on average over Q. And quite surprisingly, on average over Q, we can actually go beyond the generalized Riemann hypothesis in certain settings. Sorry. The first works in this direction are due to several collaborations between Bombieri, Fouvry, Friedlander, and Ivanich, going just beyond one half in various settings. And if you restrict to most moduli Q up to X to the theta, then there are a few works more recently that go more explicitly beyond a half. In particular, in 2020, Maynard handled moduli up to X to the 11 over 21, provided that we average over most moduli rather than all moduli. More explicitly, the condition has something to do with the factorization of Q. But in general, the best exponents that we can handle are for triply well-factorable weights, which are some very flexible weights which come up in application in applications in sieve theory. And the exponents there are limited to, well, they were limited at 3/5 due to Maynard. And more recently, we can improve them all the way to 5/8. I think I've confused alpha with theta in this notation. So here alpha is just theta. And just for context, there is an analogous story to tell for smooth numbers, which are integers with small prime factors. They're sort of the dual setting to primes. And there have been a bunch of improvements, but the latest ones are still limited at 5/8. And this 5/8 seems to be a pretty hard barrier for all methods that we know of, if we are interested in primes as smooth numbers. But for simpler arithmetic objects like the divisor function, we can do a bit better. And I'll have more on that a bit later. So this, I've dumped a lot of information on you, but this is just for some context, saying that we care about the equidistribution of sequences in arithmetic progressions, sequences of arithmetic interest like the primes. And that brings me to the outline that I've mentioned of the extended dispersion methods. In analytic number theory, you might start with a problem like showing that the primes have bounded gaps, or saying something about the greatest prime factor of a quadratic polynomial like n squared plus one, or something about the low-lying zeros of Dirichlet functions, bounds related to counts of twin primes and Goldbach representations. So a whole bunch of arithmetic problems. By sieve theory and combinatorial decompositions, they reduce to these sort of estimates about the equidistribution of sequences in arithmetic progressions to large moduli. And how do we prove these? Well, by the so-called dispersion method first introduced by Linick, which involves some clever applications of Cauchy-Schwarz and Poisson summation, and also Bezout's identity, we can reduce proving such estimates to bounding certain exponential sums. Mainly, we'll get sums of Clusterman sums. I'll define these a bit later, but there are these long exponential sums in which we expect to have cancellation. And that cancellation will translate to good bounds in arithmetic problems of interest in analytic number theory. And these exponential sums, they can be bounded using methods from two fields. And this is where it all gets interesting to me. We can use bounds from algebraic geometry, like the Weyl bound and the Ramanujan bound, and also bounds from the spectral theory of automorphic forms. More precisely, from these sums of Clusterman sums, we will be able to apply the so-called Kuznetsov trace formula to obtain expressions involving the coefficients of automorphic forms for GL2. In particular, we will be interested in holomorphic forms, mass forms, and Eisenstein series. I'll get to all of these a bit later. Now, I'm just going over the main keywords. And if you want to go even further, you know, these coefficients of automorphic forms for GL2 correspond to the local parameters of certain automorphic representations. And then tools from representation theory and L functions for general representations can help. But I'll try not to get into that too much. So overall, a rough summary is that we start from these counting problems that we care about in number theory and maybe combinatorics. We reduce them to exponential sums, and in fact, we can sort of go back and forth between these counting problems and exponential sums. And then these exponential sums relate to automorphic forms in turn. And in between these steps of going between counting exponential and automorphic forms, we need to apply Cauchy-Schwarz as well as other combinatorial manipulations. So hopefully some idea of the broad outline makes sense now, and I'll try to explain how exactly these transitions between counting problems, exponential sums, and automorphic forms work. And the simplest setting where I know of Clustermann sums showing up is the case of a divisor function tau of n in arithmetic progressions. So if you recall the type of estimates that we were trying to prove for primes, that they are well distributed in arithmetic progressions to large moduli, I would first consider the same problem, but where instead of the indicator function of primes, we have this divisor function. So this is sort of saying informally that the divisor function is well distributed in arithmetic progressions mod Q. And I'm just looking at the arithmetic progression 1 mod Q. So you can think of the first term in here as the indicator function that n is 1 mod Q as the sum we're trying to estimate when you sum over n, and of the second term as the main term that we expect to subtract. And on average, these error terms should save over the trivial bound of x over q. How do we do this? Well, this divisor function tau of n is essentially a multiplicative convolution of two sequences. And if you just break up that multiplicative convolution, you can reduce to proving an estimate of the form here that if I just take a sum over all m and n in dyadic intervals and compare the indicator function that mn is congruent to 1 mod q with the indicator function that mn is relatively prime with q, this error term on average saves over the trivial bound of x over q. So here we have gone from the divisor function to a convolution of two constant sequences. And here comes the interesting part. Once you have a sum like this, there is a version of Poisson summation that helps you analyze what these sums look like. So if e of x denotes the exponentials of 2 pi a times x, then the sum over a short interval of the indicator function that n is congruent to a mod q can be expanded in terms of exponential phases mod q. The principal frequency at h equals 0 will give a main term that's just n over q times 1, so that's just n over q, and that's what we sort of expect for such a count. But the error term can be quantified in terms of these other exponential phases. And if we apply this Poisson summation identity twice and take out the main terms, from the double sum at the top of the slide, we can reduce to a sum of Clustermann sums, where these Clustermann sums are a special type of exponential sums. So for each Q, S of H and L mod Q is the sum of E of HX plus LY over Q over all XY congruent to 1 mod Q. So these are a type of exponential sums that show up a lot in analytic number theory, especially in the dispersion method. And they relate to a whole bunch of other fields, as I've mentioned before, to algebraic geometry and to the spectral theory of automorphic forms. And if we can show that these Clustermann sums are small on average, then we are happy. We can get good bounds for problems in analytic number theory. So the veil bound that I've mentioned from algebraic geometry morally says that pointwise, these Clustermann sums have squared cancellation. So here we have a sum of length Q, and we're saying that pointwise, these sums are bounded by the square root of Q. And such square cancellation is really the best we can hope for a fixed modulus Q. And if we just plug this into our estimates, remember we have this double sum of Clustermann sums, we get that the sum we are interested in is bounded just by the square root of Q, again, just by plugging in the veil bound pointwise. And if you recall, we wanted this to be at most X over Q, and that just translates to handling all moduli at most up to X to the 2/3. So again, I think that was a bit rushed, but roughly speaking, in the toy case of the divisor function, we went from a count of a divisor function in arithmetic progressions to a sum of Clustermann sums, these S of H and L comma Q. And we just applied a bound from algebraic geometry pointwise to each of them, and that allowed us to handle moduli as large as X to the 2/3. But I've mentioned this is a toy setting, so really in more complicated settings that we are interested in, like for primes and smooth numbers, we need to apply Cauchy-Schwarz in between these applications of Poisson summation. And instead of just reaching some simple sums of Clustermann sums, we will reach expressions of the following form. I know this looks a bit messy, but basically we have an average over the modulus C of a Clustermann sum, where the entries M and N have corresponding bilinear sums. So you have a sum over M, a sum over N, with some rough coefficients A, M, B, N of a Clustermann sum. And it's precisely these sums that are amenable to methods from the spectral theory of automorphic forms. And just looking a bit ahead into what this will mean, the methods from the spectral theory of automorphic forms will introduce some dependencies on Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture and the best progress we have towards this conjecture. And what we've done in recent work is eliminate this dependency as much as possible by looking closely at these exceptional mass forms, which are a type of automorphic form. So now I'm sort of done with the combinatorial part of the talk, and I'll try to talk a bit about part that has to do with the spectral theory of automorphic forms. So maybe it's a good time to just pause for any quick clarifications or questions about what we've said so far.
I don't have a question, but just wanted to say that exceptional mass forms are something you'll be introducing afterwards in the second.
Yeah. So the second half of the talk is about these automorphic forms. Okay, so Maybe it's somewhat intuitive how these sums of exponential sums come up just by applications of Poisson summation, and exponential sums are very common in analytic number theory. But it was certainly more mysterious to me at first how you'd go from this to anything involving automorphic forms. I didn't even really know what automorphic forms were. So for a bit of setup, we'll recall that the special linear group SL2 of Z acts on the upper half plane by the canonical action AZ plus B over CZ plus D. And we are particularly interested in certain subgroups of this special linear group called the congruent subgroups gamma zero of Q, which consist of all matrices where the bottom left entry is congruent to zero mod Q. And we will be looking at functions that are almost invariant with respect to this action of gamma zero of Q. So it makes sense to look at the fundamental domain, which is the upper half plane module of this congruent subgroup. This fundamental domain will have cusps. I'm sure you've seen many pretty pictures of it. Maybe I should have included one. And these cusps are basically points which you need to add in order to compactify it. And among these cusps are, for every given Q, among these are the cusps at 1 and at infinity. I guess the definition of automorphic form is of automorphic forms is a bit more complicated, and not everyone agrees on what exactly should count. But for our purposes, we will just require that an automorphic form is a function from the upper half plane to the complex numbers, which obeys a transformation law with respect to the action of gamma zero of Q. So if we didn't have this term of CZ plus D to the K, then that would mean the function was actually invariant with respect to the action of gamma naught of Q. But in general, we have both a level Q and a weight K, and the weight K comes in through this factor of CZ plus D to the K. So we will require such a transformation law, which you can think of as an almost invariance under the action of gamma naught of Q, as well as some growth conditions near every cusp. We don't want our functions to blow up too quickly near the cusps. And we actually call an automorphic form a cusp form if it vanishes at every cusp. And what's nice about these cusps is that automorphic forms can be free expanded about around every cusp A. The most common expansion that I'm sure you've seen is that with respect to the cusp at infinity. And if you denote by Q equals e to the z or something like that, then you get all of these nice expansion of automorphic forms as a sum of some coefficients type times Q to the n, which obey all sorts of identities. Some with combinatorial origin, some with origin that has more to do with the structure of automorphic forms. And among these automorphic forms, we are particularly interested in three types. The first types are the classical modular forms that that show up in all of number theory, which are holomorphic and have even weight K. Other important ones are Eisenstein series, which have weight zero, and they are eigenforms of a hyperbolic Laplacian, which is this operator that's kind of the Laplacian for the corresponding metric on the upper half plane. And also mass cusp forms, which also have weight zero and are also eigenforms of a hyperbolic Laplacian, but they are square integrable with respect to the metric on the upper half plane. And the Kuznetsov trace formula, which, as you might remember from the previous diagrams, gives this connection between exponential sums and GL2 automorphic forms, is based on the spectral decomposition of this hyperbolic Laplacian, and relates the sums of Clustermann sums that come up in analytic number theory to exactly the types of automorphic forms listed on this slide. So in general, you'd have some sum of Clustermann sums in the left-hand side, also called the geometric side. And on the right-hand side, you'll have terms coming from mass forms, terms coming from the holomorphic forms, the classical modular forms, and terms coming from the Eisenstein series. And in this decomposition of the Kuznetsov formula, the main contribution usually comes from the exceptional mass forms. So again, every mass form is an eigenform of a hyperbolic Laplacian, meaning that this delta times f is lambda f for some eigenvalue lambda. And we believe that all eigenvalues for congruent subgroups should be bigger than 1 over 4. And we call a mass form exceptional if its eigenvalue is less than 1/4. Again, we believe that these should not exist at all, but it's very difficult to rule them out. And in lots of applications in analytic number theory, these exceptional mass forms, which again we believe don't exist at all, are what gives the main contribution and the main dependency in the final bounds. So if you want, you can think of them as sort of an analog of the zeros of a Riemann zeta function, where we believe, you know, they're all nice and on the half line, but we can't really rule that out, and that has implications about error terms for the number of primes up to x and many other such counts. Here similarly, we would like to rule out all eigenvalues smaller than 1/4, but we can't do that, and that costs us a lot in estimates in analytic number theory.
Okay, just a question, please. These mass forms are just C-infini function. They are holomorphic or just smooth function?
They are not holomorphic, so that's a good question. So the holomorphic forms in number one here are certainly holomorphic, but the mass forms are not holomorphic. They are certainly smooth, and they are eigenforms of the hyperbolic Laplacian. So you can think of that as a counterpart of the condition of being holomorphic. They still satisfy some differential equation, but it's not the Cauchy equations for holomorphic functions. It's the fact that the Laplacian times f is lambda f for some eigenvalue lambda.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for the clarification. So if we look at these exceptional mass forms, even though we believe that they do not exist, unconditionally we cannot say that, so let's pick a basis of them, of all the exceptional mass forms, and we can free expand them about any cusp A, so they'll have Fourier coefficients typically denoted by rho of n, and they also have eigenvalues lambda j. Again, here the Laplacian times fj is lambda j times fj. And in practice, it's a bit more helpful to work with this transformation of the eigenvalues. So the theta parameters are given by essentially the square root of 1 minus 4 lambda. And you can already see that for eigenvalues less than 1/4, so for the exceptional eigenvalues, these theta parameters will be positive. Now, Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture asserts that there are no exceptional mass forms at all, as I've mentioned before. So that would mean that this zero wins in every maximum, so theta j is just zero for every j. And it is these theta parameters that show up in exponents in estimates in analytic number theory. So we believe that all the thetas should really be zero, but unconditionally, the best we can do is a bound due to Kim and Sarnak, that theta is at most 7 over 32. And that's based on methods from representation theory. And it's really based on this seminal result of Kim from over 20 years ago that if you take a suitable automorphic representation on GL2, its symmetric fourth power will also correspond to an automorphic representation. And these records of theta at most 7 over 32 that follows hasn't been beaten since. And that's relevant because the Costanzo formula that I've mentioned in the right-hand side, in the terms corresponding to the exceptional mass forms, it contains factors of x to the theta, where x is large. And this x to the theta will follow you and hunt you back all the way to the applications in analytic number theory. And again, assuming Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture, you can take all the thetas to be zero. But if we're trying to go around the generalized Riemann hypothesis, we don't really want to end up depending on another conditional result. We'd like ideally to get unconditional results. So now I've hinted at this Costanzo formula and what it looks like. Let me go just a bit more into details about what it looks like for particular cusps. So again, the shape of the Costanzo formula will depend on a bit on the cusps A and B that you choose of the congruous subgroup gamma naught of Q. The most important cases are when A is infinity and B is 1. So every congruent subgroup gamma naught of Q has this cusps at infinity and at 1. And then this is what the Costanzo formula looks like. So on the left-hand side, you have a sum of Clusterman sums, exactly the type of sum of Clusterman sums that shows up in the dispersion method that we've seen earlier. So this is great. And on the right-hand side, we have a whole bunch of terms. The one that I've written down here corresponds to the exceptional mass form. So you recall these exceptional mass forms can be expanded about the cusps at infinity and at one, and they'll have some Fourier coefficients, rho of m and rho of n at infinity and at one, which you can think of as the counterpart of the Fourier coefficients of classical modular forms. And aside from this term, you'll also get contributions from the so-called regular spectrum, from the regular mass forms and holomorphic forms and Eisenstein series. And this whole term that I've written down in the right-hand side, again, assuming Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture, this should vanish. There should be no exceptional mass forms, but unconditionally is going to give the leading contribution. Which is quite unfortunate. And what's nice about the right-hand side here, among other things, is that there is a bilinear structure in M and N. In the left-hand side, in these Clusterman sums, the M and N variables are linked together in these exponential sums, the Clusterman sums S of M and N comma C. But in the right-hand side, M and N are sort of explicitly separated in a coefficient, a Fourier coefficient at M and a Fourier coefficient at N. And this bilinear structure will be crucial. And then aside from this case when A is infinity and B is one, there's also the other critical cases when A is equal to B. So you could take A equals B equals infinity or A equals B equals one. And then the right-hand side looks this, looks roughly the same. It's still a sum of the a bilinear sum of these Fourier coefficients and of exceptional mass forms at M and at N, except at the cusp A rather than at the cusp infinity and one. But the left-hand side looks a bit different. It's still a sum of Clusterman sums, but we have a restriction now that the modulus is congruent to zero mod Q. And this is a bit nicer than the sum of Clusterman sums on the top, Because in particular, if the range of C is smaller than Q, then the little C's can never be zero mod Q, so the sum would just vanish. And much of the work in this area is based on the idea that you can start from a Clusterman sum, as on the left here. I'm not sure if you can see my pointer. Expand it via the Kuznetsov formula to get an expression involving the coefficients of exceptional mass forms and other automorphic forms, and then apply the Kuznetsov formula in a different way to go back to other sums of Clusterman sums that are easier to understand. So again, the transitions that I've mentioned before between counting problems, exponential sums, and automorphic forms, they go both ways, and it's important to take advantage of this going back and forth. Most arguments that use the Kuznetsov formula use it at least twice to go from, again, sums of Clusterman sums to automorphic forms and back to other sums of Clusterman sums that you can bound by other means, for example, by the veil bound from algebraic geometry. And that brings me to the sums that we mentioned before. These are really the type of sums that show up in the dispersion method. We have a sums of Clusterman sums over C from the previous slide, but also we have a bilinear structure in M and N. And this bilinear structure in M and N will fit in perfectly with the bilinear structure of the right-hand side here in M and N. And what we can do is apply Kuznetsov to the inner sums, then apply Cauchy-Schwarz, and then apply Kuznetsov again. And what this looks like is we start with the sum of Clusterman sums that we're interested in. We expand the sums of Clusterman sums by the Kuznetsov trace formula at the cusps infinity and 1. We pull in the sums over M and N, and put them inside. So this is where the bilinear structure in M and N really helps. And then to this sum, we apply Cauchy-Schwarz. And just by applying Cauchy-Schwarz, we get an inequality of this form. And in the resulting expression, we have two sums, one just at the cusp at infinity and one just at the cusp at 1. And then each of these two sums can be re-expanded in terms of the cusps at infinity, infinity, and 1, 1, and estimated using the Kuznetsov formula for the cusps a equals b equals infinity or a equals b equals 1. So the second case here. So again, first we apply the first identity here on the slide, then we apply Cauchy-Schwarz, and then we want to apply the second identity. And I won't go much more into details about this, but I think this ping pong argument where you go back and forth is really nice, and it feels like magic at first, but in a sense it's one of the deeper things that's going on here, because these automorphic forms like the exponential sums can really be viewed as a way to switch back between different sums of exponential sums and ultimately between different counting problems. And the key idea in our recent work, which should hopefully appear on archive in the following week, is that if you try to exploit the structure of special coefficients am and bn that show up in these sums, maybe that have nice Fourier transforms, then you can get better dependencies on the theta parameter and maybe completely forget about assuming Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture. And after applying the Kuznetsov formula twice to go back and forth for special coefficients, you go back to the sums of Clusterman sums, where the coefficients are just exponential phases. And by Poisson summation, so we're going all the way back now, if you apply Poisson summation twice again, similarly to what we did in the previous section, but backwards, we go back to another counting problem, which is that of estimating the number of points x and y in two short intervals y and j such that x and y x times y is congruent to one mod q mod c. So if you want, it's a count on points on modular hyperbolas, and there are many arguments looking at such things, the main one being deduced Hilarello and Garaev from about 10 years ago that plug into this setting perfectly. And taking advantage of this structure leads ultimately to better savings in the data aspect, sometimes as good as assuming Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture. For example, the exponent of 5 over 8 that I've mentioned for primes in arithmetic progressions to large moduli is exactly obtained by eliminating the dependency on Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture. That was the limitation in the previous record. And I haven't included this in the presentation because I still need to double check a few computations, but another application just for context is looking at the greatest prime factor of n squared plus one. We can show that it's infinitely often bigger than n to the 1.3, which improves the previous exponent of 1.27 due to Yogi Marikowski. And similarly, these results about primes and arithmetic progressions improve a bunch of other results about counts of twin primes and counts of Goldbach representations due to Jared Lickman. And I haven't really worked through all of these applications, but I'm more interested in the ingredients coming from the spectral theory of automorphic forms and the improvements there, which ultimately ramify to applications in analytic number theory. I think the talk is 1 hour, but I've wanted to leave a few minutes for questions. So I will end with this slide, and thank you very much for the invitation again. And I'm very open to any questions that you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex, for a very nice talk. Are there any questions? Okay. I have a few questions.
Sure.
So, in one of your slides, you said Eisenstein series of weight zero. So, weight zero Eisenstein series on which group would you consider?
For the congruent subgroup gamma not of Q.
Gamma not of Q. Oh, okay.
Yeah. This is all for level Q.
Level Q. Okay.
And the Eisenstein series have an explicit construction, so they're a lot less mysterious than the mass forms. And one way to think about them is you can consider all the automorphic forms that are eigenforms of a hyperbolic Laplacian, and the hyperbolic Laplacian on this upper half plane modulo gamma naught of Q will have both a continuous spectrum and a discrete spectrum. And the continuous spectrum corresponds to the Eisenstein series, which are parametrized by a continuous parameter, while the discrete spectrum is parametrized by the mass forms.
Okay.
And so the eigenvalues that show up for mass forms, we know they are discrete. They are explicitly given by some lambda 1, less than lambda 2, less than lambda 2, less than lambda 3, and so on. And we actually know how they grow, how lambda n grows as n goes to infinity. What's more mysterious is what happens at the very beginning. What's the smallest eigenvalue that shows up? And that's where Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture comes in. So this bound that lambda is always at least 1 over 4 is known for Q is 1, for example, so for just the full special linear group. And it's known for small values of Q up to 300 or something like that. But we have very little idea how to prove it in general. It would follow from very strong results in the Lang-Lang's program, the automorphy of M symmetric power for every even M, for example. So far, the best we can do is the automorphy of fourth symmetric powers of GL2. Yeah, and also these, I just want to mention quickly that these the Selberg eigenvalue conjecture has a lot to do with the arithmetic structure of the congruent subgroup involved. So if you don't have a congruent subgroup, if you have some other surface and some other quotient of the upper half plane, then Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture can fail. So it's really the presence of this arithmetic structure and these Hecke operators and the connection to automorphic representations that that suggests that we should have no exceptional mass forms.
And recently, of course, you must be knowing about this harmonic mass forms where the hyperbolic Laplacian is equal to zero when applied on this such mass form, then it is harmonic mass form.
Right.
Would they show up somewhere in, I mean, I'm just asking very naively, so.
I'm equally naive, if not more, about such things, but yeah, so I think the eigenvalue zero doesn't factor into the Costanzo trace formula. It's all of the others, yeah, for congruent subgroups.
Okay. And my last question was, are there any results which are unconditional on the occurrence of these exceptional mass forms? Like whether or not they appear, still the result will remain the same. I mean, in this case, I think it will affect the main term, right? As you said.
Yeah, so in some cases, you can sort of completely eliminate the dependency on these theta parameters. For example, in the exponent of 5 over 8, for primes in arithmetic progressions to large moduli, let me just find the slide. The previous record, this 66 over 107, is really 5 minus 4 theta over 8 minus 6 theta, something like that, where theta is the best you can do. And you just plug in theta equals 7 over 32 and you get this. Whereas the newer results manage to completely eliminate this dependency on theta by making use of a special coefficients m and bn that show up. So yeah, this 5 over 8 doesn't depend on the progress towards Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture anymore. Yeah. It stays at 5 over 8 even assuming Selberg.
Okay. Okay. Nice.
In other applications, like the greatest prime factor of n squared plus 1, so the new unconditional results are that it's infinitely often bigger than n to the 1.3, and assuming Selberg's eigenvalue conjecture, you can get up to n to the 1.312, something like that. So there's still a gap in some results.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice. Thanks. Are there any other questions?
Yes. Please, you speak about the Fourier expansion around any cusp.
Yeah.
So usually when we have a Fourier expansion, we can define the L function, okay, using the Fourier coefficient. So does this mean, is it possible to define for any cusp an L function associated to this cusp, or?
That's a good question. I think they're ultimately equivalent somehow. Because yeah, for any given mass form, for example, if you take a Hecke eigenbasis, so so that you have a nice multiplicative structure, yeah, I think ultimately the L function is only one. So there must be some sort of equivalence on the way, I think.
Okay, and for the Millin transformation, because we can use the Millin transformation to express the L function. So it's the same Millin transformation for any cusp, or you don't have?
Right. So I don't actually know. That's a good question. I should look into that. But yeah, I would assume there's only one L function. And if you take the Millin transform, that gives you the expansion of the automorphic form with respect to some cusp, probably the cusp at infinity, and maybe that's related to the expansion at other cusps.
Okay. Because I have tried to find the answer in some books, but I don't find anything about this. So there is no answer for this question in classical books.
Yeah, I'll try to look myself. And, you know, that's a very good question. Yeah, I should know this, but I don't. I'll try to look it up and see what I get.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any further questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Alex for a wonderful talk.